must constantly look at things in a different way.
The Healthcare Education Transformation Podcast was created by two physical therapists out of the desire to learn more about the different educational roles in physical therapy and healthcare, and how healthcare education works by talking with educational leaders and people with different perspectives within physical therapy and across interdisciplinary lines on how education can be improved to disrupt the status quo of healthcare education. This is our journey, and thanks for listening. Are you a third-year physical therapy student that excels on tests when you have study guides, checklists, and deadlines? With all of the information available about how to prepare for the NPTE, it's easy to get disorganized and not feel prepared going into the big day. NPTE Prep Success is an online course that provides PT students easy-to-use study guides and step-by-step guidance through the NPTE preparation. To learn more, visit kylericeprep.com. Thank you again all for your continued support, and now for the show.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of the Healthcare Education Transformation Podcast. I'm your host, F. Scott Feil, and I'm joined this morning by a very special guest, Dr. Joe Tatta. Joe is a pioneering expert in lifestyle interventions. He's a physical therapist, a nutritionist, an ACT trainer. Joe, tell us a little bit about what you're up to these days and your educational journey and how it kind of led you to where we are today.
I've been a physical therapist since 1997. I've worked in lots of different areas in healthcare and pain care, obviously. I spent the first part of my career, I spent about 3 years working in a multidisciplinary, both inpatient as well as outpatient rehabilitation hospital here in New York City. That was a great experience for a new physical therapist. I got to work as part of that multidisciplinary team and see how all the rest of the disciplines function to help people, obviously, with chronic pain as well as other types of chronic disease. Then from there, I kind of did a 360, so to speak, and I worked for about 3 years with Broadway dancers. I live in New York City. So there's a practice here in New York City that specializes in Broadway performers and athletes. So I did that for 3 years, which is a lot of fun. It allowed me to kind of put on a different hat and look at, obviously, sports and dance medicine, although chronic pain does show up in those populations as well. So even that, chronic pain has been calling me, you know, kind of since day one. And then for most of my career until recently, when I started the Institute, I worked for a multi-location physical therapy practice where I was in charge of not only treating patients, but also the mentorship of new physical therapists and the clinic directors that oversaw each facility there. We had about 16 facilities. So mentorship of new grads and, you know, professional development has been a big part of my career.
Yeah, that's awesome. I know you've also written a book and you kind of, you've also got the Integrative Pain Science Institute as well. Can you tell us a little bit about those?
Sure. About, I think it was sometime in 2015, I was really encouraged by someone who I hired as a mentor to write a book about chronic pain. Because I knew as a physical therapist that obviously it's a large problem that we see both in clinical practice and it was growing. You know, chronic pain has grown since I went to school in 1997. We haven't really been able to reverse it or slow it down any yet, although I think we're making some good headway now. So I decided to write a book, and I wrote the book from an integrative perspective. So in that book, the book is called Heal Your Pain Now. There's a section there on nutrition. That's probably one of the largest sections of the book. There's a section on movement and exercise, and there's a section on what I call the brain in pain, which talks about things like cognitive behavioral therapies, mindfulness, and pain science. So those three topics are kind of, you know, grouped in that part of the book. The book, it's a pretty big book, and it's designed for someone with chronic pain to read, to be a guide, but a lot of professionals have read that book as well, mostly physical therapists, but also people like massage therapists and physicians and acupuncturists and naturopathic physicians. You know, there are a lot of different types of licensed practitioners who help people with pain. So from that book, I would get a lot of emails and say, hey, I read this part about ACT. How do you know ACT? What can you tell me? Or I'm really interested in how nutrition affects pain. Can you, you know, what was your journey with regard to nutrition? So from that, I saw that there was obviously a need for practitioners to learn integrative strategies for treating chronic pain. So from there, I developed the Integrative Pain Science Institute, where I'm now training practitioners, both online and off, but most of the courses are online.
Awesome. You know, Joe, we have a good mix of faculty, clinician, and student listeners. And knowing what we know from an evidence standpoint, what would you say is some of the most effective nutritional strategies for assisting with management of persistent pain? Knowing how vast this topic could be, I get it. But, you know, what are some of the top points that the faculty, clinicians, and students should know about this stuff?
Yeah, the topic of nutrition, as you mentioned, can be vast. I mean, you can go back for a PhD in nutrition if you really wanted to. But the interesting part of nutrition is, as far as the behavioral change goes, the lessons to help someone with chronic pain can be quite simple. And you can kind of go down the list and kind of, a bullet point. So if it's, if we're talking to faculty and let's say looking at physical therapy faculty, and they may not have nutrition as part of their curriculum because there's no CAPT requirement for it currently, looking at a plant-based diet first, so helping your clients or your patients shift to a mostly plant-based diet, that would be at least 5 servings of fruits and vegetables. Although the research that we have that's developing on chronic disease shows that those who have a chronic disease need upwards of 9 to 10 servings of fruits and vegetables a day, mostly in the form of vegetables. So 5 servings may be good enough for healthy individuals who have no chronic conditions, but really 9 to 10 for those with a chronic condition. Looking at omega-3 fatty acids specifically, because they're anti-inflammatory, it's one of the best natural anti-inflammatories we have within our whole food diet. Then looking at sugar, helping someone decrease their sugar intake, that's both added sugar, meaning the sugar they're putting in their food, let's say scoops of sugar in their coffee in the morning, or sugar that's added by our industrialized food processing. The average American is consuming about 150 pounds of sugar a year. It's a major problem with regard to chronic disease, especially chronic inflammation. So we can help people just by helping them read a label on a box or a can or a bag that they're buying in the supermarket. And then, let's not forget there are things that a lot of us have been doing for years, such as buying coffee in the morning from coffee retailers that the food tastes very good and the coffee tastes great, but your average Starbucks coffee has 10 teaspoons of sugar added to it. So you're starting your morning off with more than what the American Heart Association would recommend for just general baseline health. And then as you get into kind of nutrition, functional nutrition and testing, then you start to look at things like B vitamins and D vitamins and zinc and selenium, which are important for thyroid function, which are important for metabolism and obesity and health. So you look at the micronutrients and you can identify those just by looking at the food in someone's plate. So those would be the top, strategies. The one I left out, but I talked about it briefly as far as sugar, but just looking at a low glycemic diet. So even if you are eating whole unprocessed grains, if you're eating 6 to 9 servings of grain a day, that's too much grain for the average person, unless they're extremely active or an endurance athlete or a high intensity athlete. But looking at the glycemic index and the glycemic load and helping bring that down can be really powerful. The reason why that is because if you have clients and patients with dysregulated blood glucose, dysregulated sugar, which is a significant problem in our culture with prediabetes and diabetes, then helping them with obviously a low sugar diet and a low glycemic impact diet can be a tremendous way to help their overall health.
Yeah, absolutely. And Joe, what are your thoughts on nutrition and pain neuroscience education and DPT education, and even looking back to undergraduate education at these rates?
Yeah, they're two important and distinct topics we really should look at. I guess that we can talk about it here. So the American Physical Therapy Association reached out to me in 2016. They already had some information on the books about nutrition and physical therapy practice, but they reached out to me and they said, hey, obviously the research is building and obviously the consumer interest and demand in nutrition is building. Will you join on a committee with us? There were 3 physical therapists on that committee and 2 representatives from the APTA, and said, let's look at what's out there and let's look at the research and let's look at what's happening in PT schools as well. So we actually queried PT schools. We didn't do a study on it, but we have some good information. And most PT programs currently will touch on nutrition. Now, when I say touch, that's usually anywhere between 30 minutes to 2 hours in a DPT curriculum. And that information usually falls in a health and wellness promotion class if the curriculum has, which most of them have. So the good news is that it's there somewhere. Can we go deeper on the topic? We can, although we have to also keep in mind that our DPT curriculum is already packed. So it may be something that we touch on and educate new physical therapists and physical therapists coming out. But if you have a special interest in that, and if that's your desire and that meets the needs of your patient population, it may be something that is warranted for continuing education. Would I like to see more nutrition in PT school? I would. I would love to see probably somewhere, I would say, between 1 to 5 hours, I think, in a DPT curriculum. I think we can do a lot. If there are, you know, educators listening to this, I'm more than happy to share information on how you can do that. But I think somewhere between 1 and 5 hours is appropriate for a DPT curriculum. With regard to pain neuroscience, again, a different topic, equally as important. I am on a committee. The New York State chapter of the American Physical Therapy Association has a opioid alternative task force, which I'm on. And there's about 6 or 7 DPTs that are very energetic and educated about what's happening in the world of pain care as well as opioids. So we're putting some material together to help spread the message. And what we did was we did a little study where we queried PT schools in New York State and asked them, do you have a pain neuroscience class? And if yes or no, how many hours? So out of about 15 schools that we queried, 10 responded. And out of those 10, less than about 15 hours is devoted to pain neuroscience. For most of the schools, it's less than 10 hours. And that includes not only pain neuroscience, but also includes the biopsychosocial model, as well as all the various cognitive behavioral interventions that exist. So probably the average, you know, if we take New York State as a litmus, which it probably is a good litmus test because the state's big and we have a significant amount of PT schools here, we're looking at probably less than 10 hours of some type of pain neuroscience education.
Yeah, you know, Joe, when I was going through PT school, it was a master's program at the time, and I didn't get much pain neuroscience stuff or nutrition. Now, I was offered the transitional doctorate at that same university, and as I went through, we added a nutrition course in the DPT or the transitional DPT that was taught by a registered dietitian, and that was pretty good, but there was still, I would say, very little neuroscience, pain neuroscience taught at that time. You know, in looking back, the nutrition course was certainly helpful because I didn't know hardly any of it. It was a tough course. I mean, I'll be honest, I struggled with it because I think it was a bit of a mindset shift. But yeah, I think especially with the opioid crisis, I had posted something about this the other day that, you know, the bottom line is physical therapy can certainly help. I'm not saying it's the only answer, but it's definitely one of the tools that we can use to kind of help people going through any opioid issues.
That's right. And if you look at, first of all, your experience, I think, as far as nutrition and pain science in PT school is shared amongst all our colleagues. Yeah. My experience with that is I originally had a bachelor's degree in PT and I went back for my transitional DPT. I went to Arcadia, which is a great transitional program, and they have a great health and wellness program, health and wellness course there. And in that course, you had to do a thesis paper at the end of the course. And you can choose a topic. And I said, hey, I want to do my topic on the effect of nutrition on pain and musculoskeletal inflammation. So the professor, Kristen Palombaro, who actually took my course now, said, hey, do the paper. Let's see what it looks like. So I actually did a paper. And she said, you know, this paper is really good. You should try to get it published in a PT journal. And I did. I submitted it to 5 PT journals, 3 here in the States and 2 journals abroad. The challenge is at that point, nutrition was not part of our scope of practice. Nutrition is part of the PT scope of practice now. And I think it's good because we'll see more practitioners interested. We'll see more PT research. We have a little bit of PT research out there with regard to nutrition. We'll see more of that flowing now. So helping people with opioids, of course, pain neuroscience education is important. Of course, healthy movement is important. Well, when you look at the bidirectional relationship on obesity and osteoarthritis, when you look at the shared mechanisms on things like mood disorders, anxiety, and depression with regard to nutrition and pain, these are topics as physical therapists, you know, we're expanding our knowledge about, and we're opening up to these topics as far as educating our patients about it in the clinic and in the various places that we work to educate people, whether it's online or off. So they're fascinating and interesting times, because I think what's happening is our professional as well as our personal scope is rapidly expanding in PT, which I think is so cool because it's what we need right now. So just think, if you're someone who has chronic pain and you haven't found relief or help or support in a way to cope with it in a healthy mechanism, how awesome would it be if you have one practitioner, such as a physical therapist, who can integrate the pain neuroscience, exercise and manual therapy, along with nutrition? Like, that combination right there, those three are so powerful with helping people with chronic pain.
Yeah, you know, Joe, you bring up an interesting point, because you've got people like Jeff Moore and Tim Flynn with the Pain Reframe podcast trying to put out great information about pain. You've got practitioners that are physical therapists and registered dietitians. I've seen Austin Wynn and Patrick Berner doing some great things with nutrition and physical therapy. So it makes total sense. I mean, it's a great fit when you really think about it. You know, at first it seems like an odd dual degree to have, but then really you look into it and you're like, no, that actually is a really good fit. So tell us a little bit about this functional nutrition for chronic pain course. What does it consist of? Give us some context to that course.
Sure. So this is a course. I created this course as kind of the course I would have wanted if I was in physical therapy school, on how nutrition relates to pain and chronic disease. So it's an online course. It's offered through the Integrated Pain Science Institute. It's 36 credits. So you get 36 CU credits. It's fully approved in every state for PT continuing education, as well as accredited by the Federation of State Boards of Physical Therapy. It's a 12-week course. And it really takes you through the foundational information of what you need to know as far as physical therapy practice and pain care in general with regard to nutrition. So obviously we look at foundations of nutrition and evidence-based nutrition. We look at how nutrition affects the microbiome, or how the microbiome affects your entire body and health. We look at how nutrition affects nociception and the brain and central nervous system. We look at how nutrition affects longevity and cognition, which is a really important topic with the baby boomers aging. So it really takes you on a kind of a lifestyle journey of how our disease care model currently looks at pain, and how you can implement nutrition or functional nutrition into more of a lifestyle intervention, a lifestyle model for people with pain. So 12 weeks long, but it's a content-rich course. And as you mentioned before, there's a bit of a mind shift that needs to start to happen for physical therapists and other practitioners as well. I have physicians in the course, and acupuncturists in the course, and health coaches in the course. So there's that mind shift that starts to shift between, okay, instead of reaching for the Advil, the Aleve, the Tylenol, or the opioids, how does nutrition fit into this model? So over the course of 12 weeks, they learn that information. Plus, they have lifetime access to the course where they can keep coming back to it and reviewing topics that or a little bit deeper in the course.
And what is some feedback that you've been getting on the course regarding, you know, maybe some of the things that the course could benefit from, or what are some directions you may be moving forward in the future on the course?
Yeah, so the feedback, I query everyone at the end of the course. Everyone gets a course evaluation that they have to fill out to complete the course. So the great news is that 100% of the participants would recommend this course to another colleague, and 100% of the participants feel that this course fits into their current clinical practice. So I've put 80 participants through this course already, so it's been well tested. After the first cohort, the feedback I received was, well, I need to kind of go through this again, which is why I gave people lifetime access to it. It's like, okay, I understand this is, some of it is new information, and you want to come back to it to make sure that you're, you know, really embodying the information the way it should be and implementing it into practice. And then people wanted a guidebook, a practitioner guidebook, which I created for them, which guides them through each week. It's kind of like a workbook style that condenses some of the more content-rich information down into the step-by-step that they will take back into the clinic with them. So they either download that to their computer, or they print it out and take it to the clinic with them, and they use it as a resource when they're evaluating and working with pain education and nutrition education with their patients.
Awesome. And are you tracking any specific outcomes with your course participants as far as use or application or anything like that? Or do you have any plans to do so in the future?
I do. The good news with it being available for everyone for a lifetime is that everyone is in, we have a common Facebook group that is just for the members of the program. So everyone is in that Facebook group. You're in that Facebook group for life. And I have to tell you, we have one of the most actively engaged and energetic Facebook groups I've ever seen, really, where people are supporting each other with this transition to, okay, I'm a musculoskeletal physical therapist, let's say, or I'm a pediatric physical therapist, but now my scope is really broadening. So we're tracking what people are doing with the information, because ultimately, you know, one of my big missions is obviously that now that nutrition is part of the scope of practice, you don't have to go back to school to be an RD, or you don't have to go back to school for another degree, which is great, it saves you money. I want to make sure that people now take this information and put it into clinical practice, because we can really help a lot of people with this, as well as improve your practice, as well as let your referral sources and let your patients know that you have another tool to help them with their, you know, obviously their pain and their chronic disease. But let me give you a couple of examples. I'll give you a couple of case studies. So the first one I want to mention is Kirsten Palombaro. So she was my professor in the transitional doctorate program, who joined my course. And she took the course because she really wants to help frail elders and people with cancer. Two really important groups, especially chronic pain post-cancer. The rates of chronic pain post-cancer, because many of the techniques and treatments we have for cancer, which are great for treating or in effect killing the cancer, unfortunately damage our mitochondria. And when the mitochondria in your cells are damaged, oftentimes you have symptoms of pain and or fatigue. Nutrition is a wonderful way to help support those patients post-cancer. So she's working on that. Lauren Barr, who's a physical therapist, she's working on the intersection of chronic pain and anxiety, in women especially. She has predominantly a women's health practice. What's important about that is 50% of those with chronic pain also have anxiety. So it's a really beautiful marriage of the two. Darcy Peach supports children with neurodevelopmental and behavioral challenges. I think it's one of the most important topics of the day when you look at the rising rates of developmental delay in children as well as autism. Then we have physical therapists that are interested in other things, like Brian Kittleson is really interested in how our government dietary guidelines influence our health. So oftentimes the food on your plate, the food that goes into your shopping cart, which is, you know, put on your plate for your entire family, is influenced by our government. So there are positives to that, and at times there can be challenges to that as well. So he's looked at how nutrition has affected his entire family, both himself as well as his kids. So that's kind of, you know, moving him. And then David Wallace, who really is interested in autoimmunity. So if you look at probably about half of the chronic pain conditions we have an autoimmune basis to them, which means they are chronic inflammatory conditions. And autoimmune disease is a chronic inflammatory condition. And what's great about David is that he's starting his own private practice. So he knows, okay, I'm going to have to really shore up the banks of my practice as much as possible to make it successful. So he's working on nutrition as part of that. So, you know, what's interesting is as you know, varied as we are as physical therapists working in orthopedics and pediatrics and home care, there are physical therapists in every level of care in my program implementing the information. That's what's really exciting, is to see how it's going to start to really trickle down to all those different branches that we work in.
Yeah, that's awesome. You bring up a lot of really cool and innovative techniques and practices and applications. I know as far as the governmental regulations, had you ever seen that documentary Fed Up?
Yeah.
You know, I'm a huge documentary fan, but I always approach them in a very skeptical manner. I never take them for, you know, 100% truth or what they're worth. I just like to see what the information is and how it's presented, knowing that they're trying to make a point and they're trying to push their agenda.
Yeah.
Some of the stuff that was presented in that Fed Up documentary, I think Katie Couric was the one that produced that one, was just mind-blowing as far as what the government did to allow sugar to just kind of freely flow, you know, into our foods without any sort of quote-unquote daily recommended values, which is even funnier, because should there be a daily recommended value of sugar? Probably zero, right?
Right. That's right. People ask me, you know, how much sugar am I allowed? I'm like, well,
none.
Probably not. Probably close to zero, actually. Yeah. And look, you know, birthday cake and celebrations, we're all human and we all enjoy the taste of certain foods. But we want to help people. That's ultimately what all of us went into this for, is to really help people on a deep level. And combining nutrition with all the other things we know as a physical therapist is a great way to do it. you know, let's keep in mind that the USDA, which has done some great things, and they have some new guidelines coming out in 2020. So we'll see what happens. But as consumers, we have to keep in mind that the USDA is the branch of government that provides subsidies for farming, which is important, but they're also the same branch that make the guidelines for what we're eating. So if, you know, there may potentially, and there probably is, some conflict of interest that happens there. And I can give you a simple example is that when you look at that USDA guidelines, they recommend you drink milk, 2 glasses, potentially 3 glasses, because you're having a glass of milk with every meal. And the fact is, as you age, your lactose intolerance to dairy products is about in line with your age. So 40% of 40-year-olds are intolerant to dairy. Now, we're not necessarily going to kill anyone with an intolerance. It's not like an allergy, but this is what causes people to have stomach upset and IBS and dyspepsia and loose stools and all the things that, as you're a physical therapist and you're taking a history, ask your patient, how many times a day do you have a bowel movement and what does that look like? And it tells you a lot about someone's diet. People will tell you, well, I go to the bathroom 3 times a day and it's really loose and runny. Or the flip side of it is most people will tell you that I have a bowel movement about once every other day, which tells you they're constipated. Healthy bowel movement should be 1 to 2 times a day. And it should be, you know, so we can talk about poop on this podcast if that's okay. It should look like an S. And that tells you that a healthy bowel movement means a healthy diet. What's to kind of connect that to chronic pain, when you look at the studies on fibromyalgia, it's very clear that anywhere between 75% to 100% of patients with fibromyalgia have IBS. So you can target that from a pain neuroscience perspective as far as getting the noise in the nervous system to quiet down through things like mindfulness-based stress reduction. But the other way you target that is through nutrition. And my argument would be is if you can target it through both, so you're targeting from kind of the top down and bottom up ways, you're going to help that patient on a much deeper level.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great point, Joe. Well, we've heard a little bit about where your course is heading direction-wise, but what's up with you? What's coming down the pipeline for Joe over the next couple of months to years?
So my real goal and focus right now is the Integrative Pain Science Institute, where I have a number of courses that are coming out with regard to the biopsychosocial model of pain. I have, of course, the nutrition one is out now. I recently launched an exposure informed by acceptance and commitment therapy. So there's an ACT for Exposure course that is currently running that you can purchase. And next, I'm going to have an ACT, an acceptance and commitment therapy course for chronic pain, a specific ACT for pain course. And there'll be a couple other courses rolling out. All the courses, as I mentioned, are fully accredited through the FSBPT if you're a physical therapist, so you can get credits no matter what state you're in. And really just to get this information into the hands of practitioners to help them deepen their skills and the tools that they have, as well as helping them really build a practice. I'm really a complete supporter of physical therapists really taking the lead in pain care. And probably if I really think long term, I would really love to see physical therapists solidify themselves as primary care providers for chronic musculoskeletal pain. We have done that already. There are certain places where we're doing that and it's been studied well, but I would just love to see the scope of practice as far as physical therapists broaden so that we can provide primary care to the neuromusculoskeletal population. Our DPT is sufficient enough and deep enough that we now have the skills to do that.
Yeah, absolutely. Well put. Well, Joe, we like to ask all of our guests this one final question. If you could change one aspect of healthcare education, whether it be DPT or otherwise, what aspect would you change and how would you go about changing it?
It's a great question. Just I'll give you two. First, there has to be a trend in our education toward more behavior change. Teaching practitioners how to instill effective and rapid behavior change in the patients that we're working with. Because we can have all the didactic knowledge possible about pain and nutrition and movement and exercise and manual therapy, but ultimately it comes down to behavior change in your client and your patient. If you can effectively help that person with behavior change, usually within the first 30 days, we are seeing people for about 30 days, then we can give that person a good head start as to reversing their chronic pain or reversing their chronic disease. The second, I think, is technology, helping people leverage technology in a deeper way, whether that's working with clients one-on-one or whether that's doing things in a group format. We have a lot of research on group technology. If we can take those behavior change strategies that we have and leverage them into technology with groups, then we can really start to rapidly reverse the chronic disease that we're seeing in the United States of America. I mean, if you look at the amount of disease we have with regard to just metabolic syndrome and chronic pain, those two right there are overwhelming to our sick care system. The only way to take our sick care system and to reach the people that need the information, I believe, is through leveraging technology in a way that it helps with behavior change. So they're part of the same, they're part of the same topic, but those are the things I'd like to see us talking about more and more.
Yeah, I love that. Not a common answer that we've heard. So I definitely appreciate that. Joe, I can't thank you enough for your time and for coming on the podcast today. Where can people reach out to you if they have follow-up questions or they just want to know more about what you got going on? Where can they reach out to you online and on social media?
Sure. You can log on to our website, which is integrativepainscienceinstitute.com. If you have a question, you can email us there. The email is support@integrativepainscienceinstitute.com. And you can find me on social media at the handle at Dr. Joe Tatta. That's my Twitter handle as well as Facebook. And of course, I have a podcast. You can follow me on the podcast. And I'll have to have you on one day, Scott, you and your colleagues on the Healing Pain podcast, so we can talk about all the great work you guys are doing too.
Well, we appreciate that. We'd love to be on. We've actually just started turning the tables recently and flipping the mic and being on the other side of it. So that'll be good. We're starting to foray out into other podcasts. So we'd love that, Joe. And again, thank you so much for your time. I think our audience is really going to get some value from this episode. So I appreciate everything you're doing.
Thanks, Scott. Great talking to you today.
Access to healthcare is one of the largest issues facing both providers and patients, as millions of people worldwide lack timely and affordable access to healthcare. Anywhere Healthcare, a telehealth platform, is a simple, low-cost option for providers and patients that eliminates the barriers to access to all kinds of healthcare. To find out more, check out anywhere.healthcare, which is available in our show notes. And if you use the code HET in all caps when you email to sign up, you'll save 25% off the total cost.
Thank you for attending class today, and we hope that you learned something and gained value from the content.
If you'd like to schedule office hours with us, feel free to add us on Twitter at HET Podcast, on Instagram, HET Podcast, on Facebook, The Healthcare Education Transformation Podcast, and the homepage, healthcareeducationtransformationpodcast.com.
And for those of you following along in the syllabus, extra credit can be obtained by liking us, sharing us, and leaving a review.
Let's continue our journey up Mount Educational Success as lifelong learners.